Hello, everybody, and welcome to Saddleback. Today, we're going to continue our series on how God turns setbacks in our lives into comebacks. Now, in each message that we've been doing in this series, we've been looking at a different kind of setback and how a person in the Bible handled it. We started by looking at when you've had a business setback, and we looked at Peter, who was a professional fisherman, who said, "We fished all night and caught nothing," and how Jesus turned that around and brought a comeback in his life. Then we looked the next week at Job and his devastating setback, and what do you do when you've had a setback that seems irreversible? Now today, I want you to look at what to do when your setback isn't your fault. What do you do when your setback isn't your fault? You know, honestly, it's often easier to deal with a setback when you know that you caused it by your own mistakes. It feels more unfair when you're going through a storm or you're going through a setback or you're going through suffering that was caused by other people's mistakes, by their poor decisions, or even by their sins. And you're the innocent party that gets hurt, or you feel the brunt of their consequences, or somebody else's harmful decisions affects you. Now, those of you who have been deeply hurt by other people, you know exactly what I'm talking about. You know, maybe right now you're dealing with a setback from a divorce that you did not want. Or maybe you're paying the price of a bankruptcy that wasn't your fault. Or maybe you inherited some problems from your parents. Or maybe you lost your job because the company got bought out. That's not your fault, but you're feeling that setback. You know, I know some of you have really struggled with your identity and your emotions and your mental and physical health because of some evil person who abused you. And as your pastor, I grieve with you. And I'm sorry. I'm sorry for what was done to you. Now, these are the major storms of life. They're not your fault when somebody else brings them into your life, but they can wreak havoc on your health and on your hope and on your happiness. Now, this is the kind of setback that I want us to consider today. And I want us to see how God helps us and turns these kind of setbacks into comebacks. Now, in Acts chapter 27, you can take out your message notes, or if you've got a Bible, open to Acts chapter 27. All the verses we're going to look at are in that chapter. There's a very dramatic example of how we often suffer because of the foolish choices of other people, the ones they make, and how you need to trust God for a comeback from setbacks that were caused by other people's dumb decisions. This is the story of how Paul survived a storm and a shipwreck that wasn't his fault. Now, let me give you the background. The Apostle Paul had always wanted to go to Rome to preach the gospel, and it was his greatest desire and his greatest dream to go and preach in the Colosseum. Rome was the greatest, the most powerful, the most influential city in the world at the time. But the way that God got Paul to Rome was not through a preaching series, but through being a prisoner. Paul had been unfairly put on trial for a crime that he didn't commit, but because he was a Roman citizen, he had the right to appeal to Caesar in capital offense cases. So he did. And he used his appeal to Caesar to actually get a free ticket to Rome. Now, we're going to pick up the story where Paul is put on a prison ship in Crete, which is an island in the Mediterranean Sea, and he's headed for Rome, and the ship is docked there on this island of Crete, but the crew has spent too much time on shore leave, and now the autumn winter was turning into, I mean, the autumn weather was turning into winter, and it would now be unsafe for them to sail in the middle of the winter. So God tells Paul to warn the captain of this prison ship that they should wait until winter is over, and then they would sail smoothly. But the whole crew gets impatient, and they didn't wait, and they would sail into a massive storm. They would be shipwrecked, and they'd all likely die. Paul passes on what God told him about this, but they ignored it. And just as Paul had warned them, the ship was destroyed in a huge storm. Now, there at the top of your outline, Acts chapter 27, verse 41 says this: "The ship struck a reef and ran aground, and it was repeatedly smashed by the force of the storm's waves, and the ship began to break apart. This is the story of Paul's shipwreck. Actually, Paul was in three different shipwrecks in his lifetime, if you can imagine that. What does this story have to do with you today, 2,000 years later? Well, it actually answers three very important questions. First, what causes people to make bad choices that create setbacks and storms for other people? That's covered in this passage. Number two, what do you need to know about the storms and setbacks that aren't your fault? We're going to look at that. And number three, what do you need to remember when you're in a storm that's wrecking your ship and you feel hopeless? Okay, we're going to look at these questions. Now, what causes people to make bad choices, to make dumb decisions that cause setbacks and storms for other people? Well, that's what this story illustrates. And so you might write this down. Number one, what causes people to make bad decisions is this. First, when we listen to ungodly advice. When we listen to ungodly advice. Let's pick up the story, Acts chapter 27, verse 9 and 10. It says there, much time had been lost, and the day of fasting had passed, so now it had become dangerous to sail because of the fall weather. So Paul warned the sailors with this advice, men, I have perceived that our voyage is going to be disastrous. God had told him this. And if we sail now, we'll lose the cargo, we'll lose the ship, and likely we'll lose our own lives too. Now, the very next verse, verse 11, says this, but the Roman officer in charge of the prisoners didn't listen to Paul. Instead, he followed the advice of the pilot and the owner of the ship. Okay, let's look at this for just a minute. Have you ever been given bad advice? Yes. Have you ever been overruled by an expert, like an owner or a pilot? Yes. Have the so-called experts in your life always been right? Absolutely not. You know, I've noticed as a pastor that some people use experts to validate their biases. What they do is they go around asking experts until they find somebody who actually agrees with them, and then that's the expert they listen to. So they really don't want advice. They just want somebody to reinforce what they already want to do. Now, I don't want to belabor this. I just want to make this simple point and go on to the next verse. But when God tells you not to do something, ignore all the experts who tell you to do it because they're going to be wrong, all right? When we listen to ungodly advice, even the experts, the pilots and the captains who are supposed to know what they're doing. The second reason people sail into storms and they shipwreck their lives is this, when we copy the crowd. In other words, when we do what's popular, when we go with the flow, when we say, but everybody is doing it, when we copy the crowd, and that's verse 12. It says this, then the crew decided that they should go ahead and sail up the coast of Crete because the majority, circle that, the majority wanted to spend the winter in Phoenix, and it had a nice harbor. Isn't it interesting that 2,000 years later, people still want to spend the winter in Phoenix? It's a different Phoenix because this Phoenix today doesn't have a harbor. But history shows that the majority is often wrong. And here's what it says. The majority said, let's go ahead and do it. Majority is often wrong. Story after story in the Bible, like when the 12 spies were sent in to spy out the land of Israel and 10 of them came back and said, we can't do it. And two said we can. Joshua and Caleb said we can. And they ended up spending the rest of their lives walking around in circles in the wilderness until that generation died off because the experts were wrong. Now, just as often as the experts are wrong, the majority is often wrong. You know, there are 276 people on this ship, the Bible tells us. And so when they took a vote, the vote was 273-3. Paul and his two companions, one of them being Luke, who wrote this story. Now, I imagine when they took this vote and the majority decided, let's go ahead and do it, even though Paul says, don't. God says, don't. I imagine Paul's just shaking his head going, you guys have no idea about the storm you're about to sail into. Let me ask you, can you think of anybody who shipwrecked their life because they followed the crowd? Okay, they copied the crowd. They did what was popular. Yes. And we see it every single day. Now, the second reason people sail into storms and shipwreck their lives, as I said, was because they copy the crowd. But then there's a third reason. When we count on circumstances instead of Christ, that's the next verse. We're going to get into trouble. We're going to have setbacks. We're going to run into storm. When we count on our circumstances, we listen to our circumstances more than Christ. Just because it may look good doesn't mean it is good. Verse 13, Acts 27, it says this, when a gentle wind began to blow from the south, the crew thought, notice this phrase, the crew thought they had obtained what they wanted. The crew thought they'd obtained what they wanted. They had this gentle breeze. They go, this is great, let's go. And their plan would work. So they pulled up anchor and they sailed as close as possible to the shoreline of Crete. Question. Have you ever thought that you were getting exactly what you wanted and later realized that you were headed right into a storm? That's what happened here. Let me give you another question. Is it possible that what you think you really want in life might just be setting you up for a shipwreck? See, when we pay attention to circumstances, we don't listen to what God says. We listen to what the crowd says, and we do what circumstances say. Again, it doesn't matter how favorable something looks. It says they found a favorable, gentle wind. If something looks favorable, but God has already said no, or not now, or not yet, you're going to sail into a disaster. Have you ever heard this justification? Well, it feels right, so it must be right. Or it feels good, so it must be good. You know, that's bad logic. And I've noticed that what people actually get when they get what they think they want, that they find out it's never as good as they thought it was going to be. So why should I never trust my circumstances? Because they change constantly. And they actually can change overnight. They can change immediately. Acts 27 verse 14 says this, but shortly afterward, after they made the decision to ignore what God had said to them, shortly afterward, the weather changed suddenly and a wind of hurricane force came out of the northeast and blew the ship out to sea. Houston, we have a problem. They're trying to go up the coast of Crete, and now they're blown out to sea, and they're at the mercy of this storm. So what am I saying? Listening to ungodly advice, copying the crowd, and relying on circumstances, it feels good, it looks good, will always get you into trouble. Now, the next thing we learn from this story is, what do I need to know about storms? Because if you don't know what storms and setbacks can do to you, you'll likely be manipulated by them. Now, it's very important to be aware of what storms do to you in life so that you don't fall for these traps. So let me give you three traps that storms do in your life, and they're all in that passage of Acts 27. Number one, when you're in a storm, when you're in a setback, storms can cause me to drift. They cause me to drift from my goal. That's verse 15. It says this, the ship was caught up in the storm and the wind was so strong, they couldn't sail against it. They lost all control, so they stopped trying and they gave up and they let the wind drive them drifting in every direction. Now that verse is packed with insight. And I want you to look at it again because notice, five ways that a setback can unconsciously dominate your life. He says in that verse, first, in a storm, you tend to lose control of your plan, okay? You're not in control anymore. Second, you stop trying because you're tired and you're tired of fighting the winds and the waves. Third, it says you give up. Fourth, it says you're pressure-driven instead of purpose-driven. Said, we let the wind just blow us wherever. And number five, you drift. And you drift in every direction. That's what happens when you get in a storm. Now, there's a voice inside of you that keeps saying, what's the use of trying? Why try to save this? Why try to make this thing work? What's the use in working so hard? Why make the effort? Is it worth it? Those are all things that come when we start to go through storms. Now, let me just get real in your face about this. Have you let storms and setbacks cause mission drift in your life? Have you lost your focus? In storms, we often foolishly try to control the uncontrollable, but you can't. You try to go against the wind, but it's just going to go this way and that way. Verse 17 of the same chapter, it says this, "Then the crew tied ropes around the ship to try to hold it together." This is a huge storm, and it's being battered back and forth, and in the middle of this storm, they get these giant ropes trying to tie the ship to hold it all together. Now, I don't know how in the world they would do that when they're rocking and tossing in the waves in the dark of night. Now, doing this would be difficult in good weather, but as we learn later, it's 14 days of bad weather. This just shows how fearful they were. They're trying to tie ropes around it to hold it together. So let me ask you another personal question. What kind of ropes have you been trying to use to hold it all together? What kind of ropes have you been trying to use to keep it all from falling apart? And we're going to look at a better alternative about that in just a minute. But the first thing you need to know is that when you're in a storm, okay, things are going to kind of fall apart, and you need to realize that they can cause you to drift. Number two, the second thing we learn in this story is that storms can cause me to discard. Not just to drift, but to discard. Discard what? To discard what I used to value. In other words, your priorities and your values often change when you're in pain. Your priorities and values often change after a setback, after a struggle, after some kind of setback that you don't know, am I going to get out of this? You know, when you've been in pain, some stuff just doesn't matter as much anymore. And other stuff actually matters even more to you than it ever had. For instance, if you've ever had a long-term illness and been ill for months and months, you value health a whole lot more than you ever did. Now, in verse 18 and 19 of Acts 27, it says this, that the next day, now remember, they're in this 14-day storm, the gale force winds continued to batter the ship, and the crew began throwing all the cargo overboard. The following day, they even threw out all the ship's equipment and anything else they could lay their hands on. Now, I want you to notice the progression here. First, they throw out the cargo, they're trying to lighten the ship. Then they throw out the equipment that they need to run the ship. And then later in the story, they're going to throw themselves overboard. They're going to jump in the water and swim. But this is that storms not only cause me to drift, they cause me to discard. We start throwing stuff away. And some of that stuff's valuable. Never make a major decision when you're depressed, because it'll almost always be the wrong decision. Now, there's a third thing that storms do to you, and it's the next verse. And that is this, storms can cause me to despair, to drift, to discard, throw stuff away, and to despair. Verse 20 says this, "The terrible storm raged unabated for many days, blotting out both the sun and the stars." Do you realize they're in total darkness? It's about 14 days. Now, when you can't see the sun and you can't see the stars and you're out on the ocean, you have no compass, you have no sextant, you have no idea where you are. It says, blotting out both the sun and the stars until in the dark, it says, we finally gave up all hope of being saved. Now picture this, 14 days in total darkness, no stars, no sun, no compass. They have no idea where they are. They're being tossed back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, back and forth by the waves. And they're going, we're doomed. We're finished. It's over. It's put a fork in it. It's done. You know, they finally say, we finally gave up hope. The very last thing they gave up was hope. Hope is always the last thing to go. Now, the amazing part of this story is how different Paul's reaction is to all of the rest of the crew and all the rest of the prisoners on this ship. Everybody else is panicked. Paul is at peace. Everybody else is in despair. Everybody else is cowardly shaking. Paul is confident and calm. You know, as a pastor now for many years, I have watched people react to the crises, to the storms, to the setbacks in life. And I've discovered that the true test of your faith is not how high you jump when you're singing praises to God, but how straight you walk when you're going through the valley of the shadow of the death. How do you react to storms and to setbacks? You know, anybody can be a fair-weather follower of Jesus. Now, remember, this storm is not Paul's fault. He hadn't been disobedient. He hadn't done anything wrong. He's just along for the ride. He's going to Rome. And he had actually warned them in advance, God is saying that if we take off now, we're going to sail right into storm, we're going to shipwreck. But they ignored what God had told him and ignored what he told them. But Paul is still filled with hope. Even in these days of total darkness, he's tossing in a violent sea. What in the world is this guy's secret? Well, when you face a setback or you face a storm because of somebody else's poor decision, their dumb choice, then you need to remember the same three things that Paul remembered. Before I tell you those three things, you may not realize this, but the oldest Christian symbol is actually not the cross. It predates the cross. The oldest Christian symbol is not the fish. You know the fish, the ichthus, which stands for, each letter for the word fish stands for Jesus Christ, Son of God, Savior. And that was a secret sign among Christians when they were under persecution. But the oldest Christian symbol is not the cross, and it is not a fish. The oldest Christian symbol is actually an anchor. Why? Because the Bible tells us in the book of Hebrews, we have this hope as an anchor for our souls. Now, I'm going to give you three truths right now that are like anchors that will give you stability in the most unstable situations. They're all in this passage. And when you're being tossed around and you're tempted to drift and to discard and throw stuff away that's valuable and to despair, you need to instead throw out these three anchors. Let me just give them to you, and then we'll talk about them. The first anchor is the presence of God. The second anchor is the purposes of God. And the third anchor are the promises of God. And these three anchors will prevent you from drifting and from sinking. You throw out these anchors. They're called drift anchors. Now, what do I need to remember specifically when I'm feeling hopeless? Well, the Bible tells us also in this story, three things God wants you to remember. Write these down. Number one, when I am feeling hopeless in any situation, first, I remember that God is with me. He hadn't left me. You're not alone. God hasn't abandoned you. God did not abandon Paul, and he has not abandoned you, no matter how dark it may seem. God is with you. He has not abandoned you. Acts chapter 27, verse 21 to 23 says this. Finally, Paul called the crew together. Now remember, they've been battling this depression and despair and discarding everything and drifting for days and days and days in the dark. Finally, Paul calls the crew together and he said, men, if you'd listen to me, okay, I got the right, cold told you so, you would have avoided all of this injury and loss. But, Paul says, take courage. Here's the positive message. Take courage. None of you will lose your lives, even though the ship will go down. He says, it's going down. There's going to be a shipwreck. He says, for last night, an angel of God, an angel of the God I serve and belong to, stood by me. Circle that phrase. An angel of the God I serve and belong to stood by me. Now, you can't see God. You can't see him physically with your eyes. But right now, God is standing by you. Because God is omnipresent. That means he can be everywhere at the same time. And I don't know what you're going through right now as you hear me saying these words, but I do know this, God is with you. He has never not been with you. He's never been nearer than he is this moment, and he's never been farther away than this moment. You say, well, I don't feel him. It has nothing to do with your feelings. It has to do with the reality and the truth that God says, I will always be with you. I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. God does not break his promise. So the first anchor when you're in a storm is to remember the presence of God. He is standing by me. He's right there with me. I don't have to, he's not like way up in heaven. He's right there with you. And if you have crisis in your heart, he's actually in you. That's the first anchor, the presence of God. It'll give you stability in the storm. Here's the second anchor that you need to throw out when you're facing these kind of storms or setbacks. And this will give you hope. First, I said I remember that God is with me. Number two, I remember that God's purpose is greater than this setback or this storm. God's purpose for my life is greater than any storm I'll ever go through or any setback that I'll ever go through. And that gives me hope. That's what we read in the next verse, Acts 27, verse 24. And Paul says this, God's angel said to me, don't be afraid, Paul, for you will certainly stand before Caesar. You know, it probably didn't look like that when they're out there in the middle of the ocean and 14 days of black darkness and can't see the sun, can't see the moon, can't see stars. But God says, don't be afraid, Paul, you will not might, you will, not hope, you will certainly stand trial before Caesar. That way he's going to get to share his testimony with the emperor of the Roman Empire. Now, what's more, God in his goodness, Paul says, has granted, the angel says to Paul, God in his goodness has granted safety to everyone else sailing with you. Did you get that? Nobody's going to die, even though there's going to be a shipwreck, because they're with Paul. And on behalf of Paul's faith, he said, everybody else is going to make it with you. Now think about this. If God's presence is always with me, it means that storms and setbacks cannot separate me from the love of God. But if God's purpose is always in full work, then storms and setbacks cannot change God's purpose for your life. Okay? I don't care what you're going through right now or what you've already gone through or what you're going to go through tomorrow. It's not going to change God's purpose for your life. God has no plan B. God says, I'll fit that into the purpose too. Yep, that too. Even my dumb decisions, yes. Even somebody else's dumb decisions, yes. I'll fit that into the purpose. So we have the purpose of God. We have the presence of God. And then there's the third anchor that'll give you hope in a storm or in a setback. And it's the promises of God. And here's the third thing you need to do when you're heading into a storm, when it looks like your ship's about to crack up. I remember that God's promises can be trusted. That's what the Bible says in the next couple verses in Acts 27. I remember that God's promises can be trusted. Verse 25 and 26, Paul says this. He's talking to the crew, to the sailors. So keep up your courage, men, for I have faith in God that it will all turn out just as God has promised. Where's his faith? Not in the ship, not in the captain, not in the pilot, not even in the boat. Where's his faith? I have faith in God that it'll all turn out just as he has promised. And then he adds on, by the way, parenthetically, nevertheless, we're all going to be shipwrecked on some island. Okay. Did he get this? He said, I know God's going to take care of us. None of us are going to die. He's promised it. But first, we're all going to be shipwrecked on some island. It actually ends up being the island of Malta. Now, this is very important. Notice this. If you're in a storm right now, God has not promised to save your ship. He hadn't promised that. He has promised to save you. You may lose the ship. In fact, they did in this case. That's not nearly as important for God to save your ship, to save your job, or whatever else you're thinking of. But he will save you. Now, I want you to look at the next verse there on your outline. Acts 27, verse 30 to 32 says this. At one point, the sailors tried to abandon the ship, thinking their lifeboat would save them. Are you getting this? But Paul said, you'll all die unless you stay with the ship. So the soldiers cut the ropes and let go of their lifeboat. Oh man, is this significant? What is the meaning of this in your life today? He says, you're all gonna die unless you stay with the ship. But if you go out there with your little lifeboat and what you put your trust in to save you, that's not gonna work. He's saying, you gotta let go of your lifeboat. So let me ask this question. What man-made puny little lifeboat have you been holding on to for your security? Some of you have been holding on to the way you look. Your appearance is your lifeboat, but you're not going to have that forever. Some of you have been holding on to your money, but you're not going to have that forever. Some of you have been holding on to your academic ability or your athletic ability, but you're not going to have that forever. You're putting your faith and trust in something that can be taken away from you, which means you don't really have security. To have true security, you must put it in something that can never, never be taken from you. What's your little lifeboat? What have you been holding on to for your security? These guys think this giant ship's cracking up, but we'll be saved by jumping in this little lifeboat. Yeah, right. What's the logic of that? You see, what have you been thinking would save you? Your good works? Your nice personality? I'm sure you're a nice person, but only Jesus can save you. Only Jesus can be your savior. But for Jesus to save you, listen, you got to first let go of your man-made lifeboat. Just like these guys did. Okay, we're going to put our total trust in God. We're not going to hold on and say, this little boat's going to save us. The big one didn't save you. Why do you think the little one's going to save you? It's not much use on a violent ocean. But the safest place to be is always right in the center of God's will. Even if you're in the middle of a storm, if you're in the center of God's will, that's where you need to be. It's safe there, even in the eye of a hurricane. So today, I want to urge you to let go of anything and everything that you think might be saving you. And just turn to Christ, the only true Savior. He's the only one. Now, I want you to notice what happens next. Acts 27, verse 34 and 36, it says, then, after all this had happened, Paul said, okay, everybody, please eat something for your own good. They hadn't eaten for days. Tells us that a couple of verses earlier. He says, please, everybody, eat something. You're going to need some strength. We're going to get ready to go swimming here. And then Paul says, he took some bread. He gave thanks to God before all of them. In other words, publicly blessed it, prayed for it, expressed gratitude to God. And it says, and he ate it. And it says, then everyone was encouraged. Did you know that there is incredibly great encouraging power in gratitude. When Paul said, you guys, you need to eat something, and he blesses it and he expresses gratitude, it says it encouraged everybody. Your attitude of gratitude with people all around you will relax them even when they're in the middle of a storm and their boat is cracking up and falling apart. And when they're fearful, when you express gratitude to God, they will be encouraged. Think about this. The ship and everything all around them is falling apart piece by piece. It's being battered by the waves, but they're trusting these three anchors and they're waiting for daylight. Now this great chapter ends with an amazing comeback. Look at the last verses. In verses 45 and 46, it says this. When daylight came, some of you have been waiting for daylight. You've been in the dark for so long. It says, when daylight came, the officer ordered those who could swim to jump overboard and start swimming to the island. As I said, it's the island of Malta. It says the rest of these people who couldn't swim, grabbed pieces of wood from the broken ship to float on because they don't know how to swim. But it says, notice this is the Bible. Everyone made it safely to shore. You realize that everybody on that ship was saved because of Paul? Did you realize that God wants to use you in the same way with the people in your life who are battling storms and battling setbacks, and battling suffering? And right now, I dare you to let God use you. Let him use you in hospitality to help people who are going through storms and setbacks right now, and that because of your influence, they will be saved, just like everybody else on that ship was saved because Paul was on that ship and he trusted God. I want you to bow your heads with me right now. Would you do that? Just bow your head. Let me just ask you to consider a couple questions before we close. How about this one? You ever feel like you're drifting? You feel like, you know, you don't have a purpose, you don't have a direction, you don't have a goal, you don't have a dream. You just feel like you're drifting through life. External forces are just tossing you back and forth. Or maybe you've been tempted to discard, to throw it all away, to throw away a job, throw away a relationship, throw away a dream, throw away a marriage, throw away a responsibility. Are you tempted to just throw it all away? How about, is there anything causing despair in you this weekend, today? Maybe you got a financial condition. Maybe you got an illness that you're facing, and that's a storm. That's a setback. You've got a health setback. Or maybe your relationship, friendship, marriage headed for the rocks. Don't give up. Don't be afraid. Just hold on to these three truths. God is always with me. He's standing by my side. I can't see him. I can't always feel him. But it's not about feelings. It's not about seeing. It's about reality. And if you learn to realize that he's aware and that he cares and that he'll be there, that'll give you strength. God's presence, God's promises, God's provision, God's power, God's peace, all of these things come when we trust his son, Jesus Christ. Now, as we close, with our heads still bowed, I want to challenge you to make a very practical and simple but courageous step of faith today. And here's what I want you to do. You maybe have been putting this off for a long, long time. As your public expression of your faith in Jesus Christ, why don't you get baptized today? Why don't you say publicly with your baptism that I'm putting my faith in the presence of Christ and in the person of Christ and in the power of Christ and in the promises of Christ and in the purposes of Christ for my life. And my faith in Jesus Christ, I'm saying to the whole world, I'm not going to be ashamed anymore. And get baptized today.